Hello, everyone, and welcome to What Neve Did This Week Instead of Studying for Her Test Next Week. This week on What Neve Did This Week Instead of Studying for Her Test Next Week, we drew more dead men. Except this time, and spoilers for literally every single Skulldog Great Pleasant book, by the way, but this time we have one that's never died. And before someone says, actually he died in the alternate erased timeline and his Dimension X version is assumably dead, I think he is dead, actually, yeah, all of Dimension X is gone, isn't it? It doesn't matter. One of those isn't even him, first of all. Serpine's confirmed that. Whether or not that's a valid confirmation is another thing. But anyway, the other doesn't exist in any timeline anymore. So if that doesn't count as, like, you know, so if it doesn't count, like, you know, the main timeline, in the main timeline, he's still alive and kicking. For how long is debatable, though. And that absolute terrible attempt at English is going to be kept in because I do not have time to edit that out. Anyway, so today I'm drawing Ravel, and I don't want to talk about the speed paint for him, okay? I don't know what went wrong except for everything, but anyway, I also drew Dexter, my boy. There's no favoritism there whatsoever, and Saracen. So let's just start with Ravel since he's the first one I drew, to be honest, and also I already have a video up all about him, and I don't like how the drawing of him turned out. And I also can't remember if Ghastly, Hopeless, and Skulldoggery met him or Dexter first, so we move. So, Ravel. I don't really want to repeat points I've made about him, but god dang it, the video I made on him covers, like, most of the things he's ever done, so I'm gonna start by talking about the speed paint instead. So, I do not like how this turned out. I'll probably redo it or fix it at a later point. But I honestly just did not have the time this week. I was like, I gotta get this done. And I have tests next week. But I'm gonna ignore that fact. So, you know, not like I liked that drawing either from the last time I drew him, but it's okay. Things aren't always gonna turn out the way we want them to. I blame his fuck-ass haircut. On design, actually, though, I did keep his confusing-ass haircut. Like, the McDonald's hairline with the side part is never gonna make sense to me. What is it? Anyway, I made him a little gaunt. Not too gaunt, though, because that's Anton's thing. This video ain't about him, though. And I gave him the little, like, divot you get on your nose from wearing glasses, because he seems like the kind of guy to have reading glasses. Also, I swear, like, anytime I draw the jacket I usually draw him in, like, the black one, and don't draw, like, his full body in that jacket, it looks like a suit jacket. It's not. It's, like, this regular jacket with, like, a lapel. Probably, like, fake leather or something. I don't know. He also low-key looks like a bit of a priest, which was unintentional. You can really tell I ran out of time drawing him too, because I mean the standing version of him and the child version got absolutely no love put into their shading whatsoever. Literally, I was drawing this before I had to, like, run off to a dance rehearsal, and, like, then I got called and I was like, shit. So I just slapped on a few colours and ran. Listen, I'm on a tight schedule here. Literally, except for Tuesdays at the moment, but I'll probably end up getting stuff on Tuesdays. I have something on every single day of the week, and that's excluding school. Including school, I have something on every day of the week, usually. Although, I didn't have anything on Saturday or on Sunday this week. So I had these 2 days free, but I was doing homework, and I have done zero study for the tests I have. It's okay. It's okay. I'm not gonna stress. It's just the first progress report test of the year. It doesn't actually matter. All is gonna happen is I'm gonna get the results, and then my vice principal is gonna sit me down and be like, what do you think you got? And I'm gonna be like, probably very low, because I didn't study. Anyway, as for him, though, I gave him, like, curly-ish hair for when he was a kid. And then I stuck it in a ponytail, because my boy is easily manipulated. Well, not easily. I mean, he was tortured for months. Years? Months. But I'm gonna pretend he is easily manipulated, for the purpose of having a reason to give him, like, more fancy-looking clothes. I think he was probably sheltered in some way as a child, although that doesn't mean he had a healthy childhood, because, let's be honest, who other than Ghastly, for some reason, has a healthy childhood and then joins a team whose whole job is to go on suicide missions? Actually, Ghastly's an enigma, but this video is not about him. The last one was, you should check that one out. Anyway, I gave him a tooth cap, actually, because I decided he had one as a kid and got rid of it when he was older. I don't know, maybe he was, like, made fun of or something. I like tooth caps, though, so I don't think he should have been bullied for that, but someone, please, God, bully him out of that fuck-ass haircut. It doesn't even look that bad, okay? But actually, just what the fuck is it, okay? Like, this haircut and me are having beef right now, because every single time I try to draw it, I just look at it and go, how does that even work? Like, genuinely, someone explain to me how his hair defies, like, the laws of existing. Fuck his hair. I don't even care that he killed his best friend and betrayed them or whatever. Get rid of the fuck-ass haircut. Ghastly fashionista best book. Why the fuck didn't you say anything? Anyway, I don't have much to talk about because of the previous video, and I feel like the page of bullet points I had, even though about 10 of those bullet points are just making fun of his haircut, but I'm not going to say everything I wrote about his haircut, because looking at these bullet points, some of it's a bit too fair. So I'm going to move on to Dexter before I do say those things. So Dexter, my boy, the pretty princess of the group. Yeah, I tried to keep, like, the pretty thing in mind while drawing him, but, like, dude, I had to give him dimples, or a singular one anyway. Sorry if you don't think so, but I think dimples are pretty AF, so don't at me on that. I'm trying not to curse anymore. I feel like I curse too much on the hair section. That's my bad. It wasn't even like, sorry, I got carried away. I'm really sorry. Anyway, other than that, I had to give him eyelashes because, I mean, he's supposed to be pretty. Pretty people have eyelashes. Duh. And as for the hair, that's my own, like, little headcanon that before and during the war he had that hair until he had his little hippie phase, and then he grew it really long, and then after breaking up with that girl because she spat on a soldier, I mean, like, he was one girl. Like, I don't know if he, like, told you that, but you can't do that. Like, in fairness though, if I was dating someone and they spat on anyone, I don't care. I'm probably, like, there's, like, an exception of about 5 people, maybe. More if we're including dead people, but, you know, out of alive people, probably about 5 people that you could spit on, and I'd be like, fair, you know? There's probably more if I had context into who the person was, but just because the person was a soldier, like, dude. I understand where she was coming from, you know, especially because she was, like, a hippie. Then, like, you know, peace and all that, but at the same time, that singular soldier probably would agree with you on the peace thing. The singular soldier probably would. It's the people above him you should be spitting on, not him. Anyway, sorry. Anyway, so after she did that, he broke up with her, and then he cut it all off like a monster. A monster because he cut it as short as he cut it, not because he broke up with Sally. I think her name was Sally. I'm not sure. Also, by the way, like, changing yourself completely for someone you love is so sad, but so, so real. Like, he grew out his hair and went vegetarian. I can already see the tie-dye t-shirts he had to burn afterwards because of the embarrassment. Not saying tie-dye tops are embarrassing, by the way. I'm saying completely changing yourself over a girl is. Also, I mean, it's not as embarrassing as it would be to completely change yourself over a man, but I wouldn't be surprised if he's done that too. Also, I have a headcanon that, like, all energy throwers have, like, a slight darker color going towards, like, their hands. I did it a bit of a reddish color in this case, because for some reason we all have this, like, weird Mandela effect in the fandom that everyone draws Dexter. I've mentioned this so often, but everyone draws him in a red t-shirt. What is with that? Is that in a book? Someone please tell me if that's in a book, because I'm so confused at where that came from. So I just associate him with the color red now. I swear every single fan artist I've ever seen has drawn him in a red t-shirt before, and if they don't, it's a white t-shirt, but I get where the white t-shirt comes from because he wears one in the cover of one of the books. Where did the red t-shirt come from? Did he wear one at one stage? He probably did. I don't know. Anyway, but if it was just, like, one or two artists, guys, I wouldn't be saying this, but it's, like, every single artist I've ever seen drawing him has at least drawn him in one red t-shirt, and usually everyone's drawing him in just red t-shirts. The odd person you see him, like, drawing him in the white t-shirt, which is one we know he's worn before. Where did it come from? Anyway, But I kind of wanted, like, the, like, gradient to be, like, barely noticeable. One, because obviously they have to be able to blend in with society. And two, because obviously, like, Serpine needs to stay unique by having his red hand. And if I gave all energy throws different colored arms, it would be a bit suspicious. Anyway, I also made, like, Kitty Dexter, like, a little roughed up and gave him the medieval kid cut. You know the one I'm talking about? Like, every single medieval show always gives it to 90% of the boy kids in it. Because, like, that was such a way to say children that are boys. What else? What other way would you say? Just boys. Yeah. Just, anyway. I can't English, guys. And these bullet points are not written by a sane person. I literally spelt medieval kid cut as medieval. I'm not spelling out the word medieval. Oh, fine. Medieval, right? Kidkut. That's one bullet point, by the way. I didn't give myself any context. This is why I mess up so much when I talk. I literally just put in bullet point, medieval kid cut, and spelt the word cut wrong. Just so you know what I'm working with here when I'm talking. Anyway, what was I saying? Oh, yeah, like the medieval cut that they give to, like, 90% of, like, little boys in, like, medieval fantasy. I don't know why they all get that. Is like, it was probably, like, a popular haircut back in the day. Back in the day, as if it's the fucking 70s. Anyway, sorry, I need to stop cursing in this video. I'm really sorry. Anyway, the point of all that, we got there eventually, was because you cannot tell me that Dexter doesn't give you street kid that used the fact that he was, like, cute and, like, pitiful looking to get, like, free food. Like, he was pulling the Puss in Boots eyes out. Because why not? Also, because he's really, like, street smart, but academically, this man has the IQ of a frog that fell off a wall. So there's, like, no way he had any sort of schooling at all. And I wouldn't be surprised if he learned how to read in the middle of the war, to be honest. I don't know if mages, like, would test their soldiers on that. But if they did, he probably just, like, bullshitted his way through it, and somehow it worked. Also, I want to tie in, like, his love for cats with, like, street cats, potentially. And I also want to believe he's a good cook, because he needs a talent, man. He can't solve Matt's problems, but God, he makes a mean lasagna. I think that would be a good thing for his character. Like, listen, he can't do basic addition. But he can make a really good stir fry. So, like, what's more important? Anyway, also, like, I don't believe you can travel that much and be that friendly and, like, extroverted without learning how to cook from, like, random strangers. And I should know, because my mother went to Italy, and as the extrovert she is, this is before I was born, by the way, she spoke to, like, this old lady for, like, 10 minutes, and she decided to just teach her how to make lasagna. Out of the blue. What? And can I just say, I don't know if she's still alive. I don't know how long ago this was. I just remember my mom, like, dropping this on me. The mom lore is incredible. But anyway, can I just say thank you to that old Italian lady? Because, like, I never met you, okay? But your lasagna is so good. Thank you for teaching my mother how to cook Italian food. It's so good. Sorry. but yeah, maybe that's just because my mother did it, and I just think it would be cool for him to do it. But I feel like if you're an extroverted person and you travel that much and you're that friendly, you'll probably make a lot of friends, and they'll probably teach you how to cook different things. And it's true that he does make a lot of friends, because, like, he became, like, friends with, like, the monster hunters and all before they even, like, knew Saracen and all. So I think, yeah, we can say that that's probably what happened, and he's a good cook, because I've decided so. We've already covered the fact that I ignore lore things because I want to. Okay? We've already covered that fact in the last video. If you weren't there for that, go back and listen to it. I don't want to recover that video. That was a thing. Anyway, I just hit the mic. I'm really sorry if that came through. Anyway, I need to stop talking with my hands. Okay, now on to, like, the actual, like, lore canon stuff. By the way, when I do these videos, I do use, like, the wiki a bit, because obviously I haven't read the first book since I was, like, 7. So, I don't remember everything that's happened. Most of the research comes from the Grimoire, which actually could be less reliable than the wiki, but anyway, or if it's a book that I know something happened in, but I can't remember exactly what happened in, I'll take out the book if You know, like the way sometimes you can just remember that something happened in a certain book. That sort of thing. But for anything I can't find that way, I do use the wiki because it's just quicker. And a lot of this video is from the wiki, and I'll admit that right now because I didn't really get the time to actually take out my books and look through them. But whoever wrote Dexter's wiki page, or to the many people that did, one of you wrote this, right? You didn't have to flame him. Because the... I'm going to read out what the wiki says, right? It says, Vex is streetwise, adaptable, and quick-witted, but complicated ideas elude him. That is so mean. Now, I do realize that that's honestly probably either from a book or a direct Derek Landy quote, because he's just that mean to him. But, like, leave him alone. He's a little dense, but Jesus, it's like... Listen, if... he's kind of like banana bread. I don't know where this analogy is going. He's kind of like banana bread. He's a bit dense, but he's sweet. And most people like him. Yep. That's an analogy. I'm going to leave that in just because I want that to sit with someone. Because I need you to explain what I just said to me. anyway, so let's start with the least depressing stuff. Because my boy's been through it, honestly. But I'm honestly, like, I'm just going to cover... I'm gonna lightly cover the depressive stuff, but not, like, overly cover it, because I'm gonna redraw Dexter and Saracen as well. And I know I said in the previous video, but I'm also gonna do Skullduggery again, because they have, like their appearances change. Like, obviously, I'm gonna mention this before we get to Saracen, because I know I'll forget to, because I don't think I put it in my bullet points. But, he's very thin in the drawing I did of him, and... that is on purpose. It is during war / pre-war him, not after war him. I realize he gets a bit chubby afterwards. I know that. I will draw that next time I draw him. How the fuck did my brother opening a door spike the mic? Okay. Anyway, he'll be shouting sometimes, and you won't hear a thing. But him doing that, anyway, it's fine. But yeah, so I'm just going to lightly cover this, as well as, like, for Saracen, I'm only lightly covering kind of him as well, because I want to leave stuff to talk about when I get onto that video, but, you know. Anyway, yeah, so basically, that'll be different speed paint. When it comes to Dexter, though, I know he has two separate appearances after this. Like, he has his, like, beard, and then after shaving... the beard, but still having the scars, I realized that, so I'm just gonna include both of those appearances in a second speed paint, because I won't be including him as a kid, so it won't matter. Yeah, so let's start with the happier stuff. So Dexter can like canonically speak French for some reason, which is so random because he's stupid. okay, he's not stupid, but he's a bit dumb, which is fine, but he can just speak French, and I know it's probably because he travels, but, like, he can speak French, so can Anton, but my thing is, I think that, like, Anton probably speaks good French, like, he has the accent fairly down, not perfect, obviously, but, like, he has the accent a good bit down, you know, but Dexter doesn't, so, for those of you who don't know, when it comes to, like, speaking French, like, I think, like, obviously with certain languages like English, you don't need to have, like, an accent down to speak it and for it to be, like, fully understandable. But in French, if you don't have the accent, there's certain words that just, especially if you're speaking fast, because if you're, like, fluent, there's certain words that just it don't sound right. And because of that, it's harder to understand. It's, like, way harder to understand. Think of someone with a really thick accent speaking English really fast. That's kind of what it would sound like. I don't speak French. I just know that from seeing French people talk about it. So, unless they're all lying, which they could be. So basically, my opinion is Dexter goes anywhere in France, and if the French person speaks English, they will speak English to him, even if he speaks French to them. Whereas Anton goes to France, and the only place that will speak English to him no matter what is Paris, because Paris even speaks English to actual French people for some reason. Like, they're like, no, your accent, like, it's just not French. And the person's like, I was born here, I was raised here, I've never left here. How? And they're like, no, it's not Paris French. It's not French. I don't know. Anyway, he's also canonically a good dancer. And he said he taught skullduggery how to dance, and I believe him, because that's also why I, like, based his body type off of a male ballet dancer. I don't know if it comes across, because obviously I'm not really drawing their full bodies, like, big enough to, like, get a ton of detail in there. But, like, tightly bound muscles and lean, you know, yeah, it sounds like a male ballet dancer to me. He also loves cats, ostriches, and waffle irons for some reason. Like, if I had to think of his top three likes, it would be those three things. Although the waffle iron thing is more of a humorous thing he made up to annoy a guy. But I think him having a fascination with waffle irons is kind of funny, so I'm just going to pretend he likes them anyway. He also had a kitten named Sabrina, which Derek Landy, of course, couldn't let him have for emotional support during the torture he was about to put him through. And the kitten assumably died of old age before the series even started, because fuck Dexter, I guess. He isn't allowed to have anything. Seriously. Like, if you want me... Like, okay, you guys aren't going to believe... Like, the people who haven't watched the series that are just, like, popping in because they're bored and need a thing in the background, because I know people do that. I do that. I'm going to list some things for you, and you're going to tell me if you think... This guy, who isn't even really a main character, like, he is for, like, a certain amount of time, but he's more of a side character. You're gonna tell me if he needs a break or not, okay? So I'm gonna list it, right? So first, Larrikin, another one of the dead men and a good friend of his, sacrificed himself to, like, save his life and died screaming, according to Dexter, because he was basically killed in a way that was excruciatingly painful. And I will go more into that in my Larrikin speed paint, like, how he died, because there's literally nothing else to talk about with Larrikin. But anyway, so, like, so Dexter basically said, oh, he died screaming, so, like, and, dude, like, that was, like, the first time we meet Dexter as well, like, him saying that, and he's so friendly when he first pops up, so you kind of have the, like, you know the, it's Markiplier, isn't it, like, the audio that's like, oh, it's adorable, oh, it's dramatized, that's, like, everyone meeting Dexter for the first time, that was everyone's impression. Anyway, then Billy Ray, I'm not pronouncing his last name because I'll pronounce it wrong. I can pronounce it, I think. Is it Sanguine? Yeah? But I can't say it in, like, a row. Like, if I try to say Billy Ray Sanguine, it doesn't work. Anyway, he scarred his throat and chest, I do believe, but he already had a few body scars, so no biggie. Then, one of his best friends and another dead man, Ravel, kills two of his other best friends and other dead men, Anton and Ghastly. Then, I'm not done, he gets possessed, and then the Remnant, who, by the way, was so zesty for some reason. Like, all the other, Remnants were, like, scary, and then Dexter's was just fabulous and he knew it. I don't know why that happened. Like, he was the only one, by the way, I just want to get that out there. Like, for some reason, this guy was just fruity. Anyway, then that thing got ripped out of his throat and left him with permanent facial scars and chronic laryngitis. Then he gives his bestest friend of over 400 years an ultimatum, basically saying, hey, tell me your magic discipline or I can't trust you. Look what our friend just did to our other two friends. And Saracen is like, nah, bud. And they don't talk for 2 years, only for another one of his friends to trick him into working on a team with Saracen again. And then it turns out that Saracen's discipline is literally just seeing through walls. And the only other reason, the only reason he was hiding it was because of teenage embarrassment. Then Saracen gets bitten by a Draugr on the arm and neck, but Dexter doesn't visit him at all, assumably because he feels guilty, but, you know, he doesn't. And then Dexter has to shoot him, because of course Valkyrie couldn't arrive in time to fix him, that would be too happy. Like, you know, we can't have a happy Skullduggery Pleasant book, that's just illegal. Anyway, on top of that, I'm not finished, on top of all that, in the prequel, it gets revealed that Dexter and Saracen liked each other for over 300 fucking years, assumably. I don't know if they, like, it was never confirmed that they still did, but, I mean, and they also assumably never did anything about it, so basically, Saracen died before they did. And why the fuck is their ship named Sexter? They're so tragic, but so, so silly. Anyway, and then I'm not done. Saracen asked Tanith to look after Dexter before he, like, died. And Tanith is like, I promise, babes. And then she did until they got out of the dimension they were in. And then she was like, go free. And I apologize for that British accent, although not really. So Dexter gets, with half of Ireland to honor his best friend, of course, you know. And the way it's said in the books was so funny to me because the books are, like, supposed to be for kids, right? Even though we've had booty call jokes and castration jokes, but anyway. So Temper says, like, he was, like, worried about Dexter because he was having a lot of boyfriends and girlfriends in quick succession, basically. Like, Temper, I love you, but you can say hookups. Like, it's not slut-shaming, if it's true. Anyway, Temper kind of does Tanith's job of keeping his head above water, but eventually he, like, got a boyfriend called Rasmus, and Temper says he likes him, so I trust him. That's all it took. Temper stamp of approval, and that's it. Temper's one of my favorite characters, if you guys don't know. So he's, like, he's kind of settled down, and he shaved his depression beard, so that's good. Even though with what happened with Temper, like, he kind of doesn't have any more friends that actually contact him. But the depression beard's gone, so... Also, Saracen saying that he was too pretty anyway, and, like, now knowing they had a thing for each other is a vile thing to do to me. Now, Derek Landy, after hearing about all these things, do me a favor and leave him alone. He's been through too much for a character that doesn't have that much time, like, in the books. He doesn't have... He's not there a lot, you know? Just let him be happy. Give him another cat or something. Also, I did notice he hasn't gone back to, like, traveling and adventuring. There's no way that's not ruined for him now, so how dare you? But anyway. Yeah, Dexter's character's always been, like, a little bit tragic to me because you can kind of see him getting more quiet and reserved as the story goes on. Like, Corvil would be eating his grow-up comment by now. Like, oh my god, yeah, I forgot. Corvil killed Derek, too. Add that to the list. Who's, like, I don't know, some people, like, headcanon him as a bit of, a father figure. He's definitely, like, a friend. And, like, I mean, he gives them advice, like all the dead men. But they don't really listen. And I mean, he does, like, kind of chastise them like children, if I'm honest, sometimes. But yeah, since the books are in Valkyrie's perspective, it's, like, really, like, subtle, to be honest. But if you, like, reread the books, he even goes from being, like, willing to lead a team if necessary and literally, like, making a team at one point to outright just refusing to ever lead one again. He also goes from being, like, the friendliest guy ever to refusing to work with Serpine and Saracen. I mean, I do get it. But it would be in your best interest to work with them babes, you know? Also, side note, that his wiki pointed out, he goes from calling Valkyrie Val to Kid, which hurts my soul. When the prequel came out, I didn't realize how big the change was until, like, he actually, like, started talking, and I was like, oh my god, I forgot he was ever happy. Anyway, hopefully Derek Landy leaves him alone, apart from a few little fun, wholesome chapters, except he 100% won't, but a girl can dream, you know? So, last but not least, on to Saracen Rue, the character that started out as a self-insert, actually, for those of you who don't know, but turned into his own character, thank God, because, like, honestly, the amount of character development that he would not have gotten if that decision, like, wasn't made. On that, this is where I mentioned that I have met Derek Landy, which is where I asked him about the self-insert thing, and he just said that, like, oh, yeah, he was one, but eventually he evolved into his own character, because keeping him as, like, a funny haha self-insert character meant he couldn't really have character development, and also, like, with, like, he saw what people were doing with him in the fandom and was like, yeah, this is his own character now, this isn't me, do you know? Which I think was a good decision. I hate self-inserts. Omen became his new self-insert, by the way, if you didn't know. It was, well, Omen's supposed to be, like, teenage him, it's based off teenage him, but to be honest, it's kind of a self-insert, I would say. And it's a better one. It's a better one, because he's not as important. I mean, not that he's not as important, if anything, to the plot, he's a bit more important, but, like, he doesn't need as much dimension as a character that's been in the series as long as Saracen, and I think it was great that he, you know, evolved into becoming his own character, and he got his own things, which is why, like, originally, he would, like, him, like, knowing things was supposed to be a nod to him being the writer. I'm assuming he was also supposed to die because of, you know, all that, like, I'm assuming when he was being poisoned, he was supposed to die, and then Derek Landy sort of said, you know what, let's make him his own character, he's not me anymore, and then he didn't die, obviously. Funny enough, though, the book signing was for Hell Breaks Loose, which is the book that Saracen and Dexter are, like, confirmed to, like each other in, so while I know the decision to make him his own character was more for, like, plot reasons, and because, you know, the fandom actually really liked this character as a character, it is kind of funny to me to think that it might have come from a, like, since the fandom was, like, so, like, there's no way Dexter and Saracen haven't done something together before, it's really funny to think that the decision came from a I ain't gay viewpoint, although I know it's not, let's get that out of the way, I know it's not, but it would be funny. Anyway, let's get on to the actual, like, speed paint. So I realized that, like, Saracen's appearance is loosely based off of Hugh Jackman. I don't know why that's a thing, but it is. But I'm ignoring that, because the only character compared to a celebrity that I agree with is Frightening Jones, because he is Terry Crews, okay? He is. Anyway, so, of course, I'm going to draw him hitting that Jim Carrey pose. I mean, other than that, he got that McDonald's hairline, just not as egregious as Ravel's. As for why his eyes are purple in the headshot, I thought it'd be cool if, since his aura is purple, if his eyes turn purple while using his discipline. It's just like a slight nod that's not that noticeable, but it's still there. Also, is Saracen's hair brown or black? Because I've seen different images and illustrations with different colors. Like, he has black hair, and then he has brown hair, and then he has black hair. Like, hello, just make it easy for me. Just pick. So I just kind of settled for, like, a brownish tinted black, so I can argue that it is brown, even though it's kind of more black. I've just always thought his hair was black, so. But I mean, it could be brown, to be honest. It probably is brown. But anyway, most people draw him with black hair, so I'm gonna stick with that. Some people do draw him with brown hair, though. It depends. It also depends on what cover of the books you got, because depending on the cover of the books you got, you would have gotten Saracen with black hair or brown hair. So, that's why there's, like, a bit of a argument there. Like, strangely enough, though, the biggest argument I've seen is on whether Dexter's hair is blonde or black, or blonde or brown, even. It's blonde. Dude, it's blonde. Like, it's always been blonde. Like, yes, his hair is darker. It's described as darker, not dark, in one of the, like, books, because, my friend, when he first appeared, it was probably bleach blonde, because it had been bleached by the sun. His hair canonically gets bleached by the sun. That's a thing, okay? My hair gets bleached by the sun. It goes like a light brown with, like, highlights through it, which is why if I recorded myself now, because my hair has gone darker again, the drawings I did of myself for my art fight thumbnails would be entirely inaccurate, because my hair is dark now, but it was light during the summer. So my hair bleaches, his hair bleaches, not everyone's hair bleaches as much as other people's. Like, mine changes a good bit, but not too much. But whether, like, then I have a cousin and hers just stays dirty blonde, like, all the time. Maybe gets a little lighter in the sun. But with him, because it bleaches in the sun, I always thought, oh, it's bleach blonde, kind of. Not entirely, but bleach-ish blonde. And then it goes to dirty blonde. That's what I always thought, right? Only for someone to say, his hair's brown. It was only blonde because it got bleached in the sun. As someone who has brown hair that does bleach in the sun, it does not go blonde. It gets blonde streaks sometimes. But it does not go blonde, okay? It doesn't, right? And to the people saying, but in the Maleficent 7 illustrations, the Maleficent 7 is in the dark, okay? That's why it looks brown. And also probably why Saracen's looks black in it. So you could argue that his is definitely brown based on that. But, you know, there's definitely a cover where he's drawn with black hair. There definitely is. Anyway, let's continue. So, the main thing y'all kind of need to know about Saracen is that if Tanith has dated a lot of people, Saracen's, like, at least doubled it. Like, at least. Anton believed that he managed to defeat the wife of a serial killer who was also a serial killer, and was really impressed because he'd been captured for 3 days and still managed to defeat him, when actually what happened was Anton had thought he had said subdued when he'd actually said seduced. But, like, 3 days? 3 days is not possible. Saracen, stop. Three days. There's no way. There was at least one break taken. What is this video? Also, like, Anton believed that story for years. And Anton, you're smarter than that. And apparently it was the only reason he respected him at all. So that was kind of funny, you know? But having said that, he ends up kind of going, like, he starts off really immature, right? And then he ends up going, like, full, like, he kind of matures as the, like, series goes on, and then he ends up going, like, full-on uncle mode around Valkyrie at one stage, especially when she, like, almost loses her fingers. Like, he was ready to kill a man, and by the way, that character development would not have happened if not for his popularity in the fandom, because he would have stayed, you know, funny, haha, self-insert, and it would have sucked, and he also would have died sooner. You can definitely tell when that switch happens, because he goes from being ruthlessly made fun of to just being made fun of as much as any other character that's there for, like, mainly comedic effect, and he gets character development. But do y'all remember when someone tried to cancel Anton for calling him fat? I don't know if you've all been in the fandom for that long, but I do. Leave Anton alone, y'all. He's done nothing. He's done nothing, okay? I will defend him on that comment. Also, if you don't call your friends fat asses, are they even your friends? It goes both ways, though. You call each other it, usually. Anyway, other than that, yeah, I mean, I kind of loved when he was dying and he was just telling Tanith that he really wanted to die by being crushed by a piano after saving a bunch of people from the fire, like, from, like, a fire, and he's giving a speech, and as he's giving the speech, he just gets crushed by a piano. That's his dream death. It's not how he died, but that was his dream death. And I really like how when Tanith mentioned it to Dexter after he was dead, Dexter was like, I know exactly what you're talking about. How long has he wanted that? And why couldn't we find him a piano, okay? I know the place is entirely desolate. There had to be one piano there. those scenes with Tanith were really sweet, though, because he was kind of just worried about Dexter the entire time. He was like, you're dying, man. Take a break. It's fine. She's not going to look after him anyway, because she didn't. I know, like, there was a whole, like, thing going on once they got out of the dimension, but she did not give a shit. I'm sorry. She forgot about it. I don't even know if they had the, like, toast to him like they said they were gonna have. They probably didn't get the time, in fairness, but not giving us that was just criminal. His deathmate was, like, really sad for me, because he had just gotten, like, all this character development, and he was, you know, being really cool, and then the next thing he died, and then the prequel came out, and it turned out him and his best friend really wanted to smooch, and they did in the Erased timeline, but that was it. And they never did, probably. I don't know. We don't actually get to see his death. It's just sort of a thing of, oh, you know, Dexter, like, takes him off into the woods and comes back alone, sort of thing. And it was really sad. But anyway. Other than that, I might leave that here, because honestly, I am really running out of time, and, I'm gonna draw After War Saracen in another video. Hairstyle inspo is appreciated for that, by the way, because I kind of drew his modern hair for some reason on his, I don't know, I drew it, and then I thought about undoing it, like, when I was doing the sketch, and then I just didn't, so, I'll go into more detail on, like, his character, I guess, then, maybe, probably. But as for now, I will see you in the next one, where I do think, I'm definitely drawing Anton in the next one. Definitely Larrikin, but I have to decide on the third person still. Probably Valkyrie, because she's probably the next one to join the dead men, realistically. Kind of Tanith and Valkyrie at the same time, I guess. No, Valkyrie does it first, and then Tanith. Yeah, okay, so Valkyrie next, probably. But yeah, I'll see you in the next one, and bye-bye. Irish Word of the Week is Gwelga, by the way, which means Irish, because I'm not creative at all.